Mother's first apartment in Tulsa, Oklahoma, in January of 2003. My mom had called him to come and pick me up so I could get a chance to meet all of the other Bahamian students that were in Tulsa, Oklahoma, and that was the first place that I met him. It was roughly about 2 years ago that I first saw him. He picked me up from the house and we went over by one of the older Bahamian students that were there. Her name was Patrice Miller, and he played dominoes for a while. I got tired of playing dominoes because they were always beating me on the table, so I got up. That was our first encounters together, is when he came and picked me up. I think it was exactly January
16th, 2003. I think that was the first time I saw this. Oh, short, you know, and then he walked into the car and I was like, okay, you know, my first inclination was she was cute. So anyhow, you know, I guess to come and take her by the apartment and play dominoes with her that night.
When I first laid eyes on Delwin, I didn't have, per se, a first line or trend of thought. But when I gave it a second thought, I was like, wow, that's a big teddy bear. He's a big teddy bear. He was so cute at first, and he still is today. He was so cute. I looked at him and I smiled, and he asked me my name. And the way he asked me my name was, what's your name? What's up? Or whatever. And I said, Marissa. And I said, what's your name? He said, well, they call me Punt, but Delwin. But when I first saw him, he was very gentlemanlike, very, very gentlemanlike. He opened up the doors of the apartment. He opened up the door of the car, made sure I was in first before he got in, those kinds of stuff. So when I first saw him, very pleasant to behold.
I guess I was thinking, she looks a lot like her mother, right? Like I said, I thought she looked really cute. She was a cute girl, person. But, you know, that's just, you know, I thought of it.
Our first date was at Sbarro's in Nassau on Cable Beach Strip. We went to go and get something to eat first, and then we were going to the movies. We've had a lot of other encounters, but our first date was at Sbarro's. I had the fish, he had, of course, the pizza. I had large drinks, very, very large drinks. I love to drink. And that was his first thing. You got to get this big cup of drink. Whatever, but yeah, that was our first date. Was at Sabaro's, and then we went to a movie at R&D West.
The first time I realized that Marissa maybe, you know, could have been the one was, I think we was at Lionel's birthday party, a party by Lionel's house. And she invited me to the party, and we were talking outside. And I guess what we were talking about really, you know, caused me to think about it, you know, at that particular time. Because I remember that same night I asked her if she thought that we could be more than friends, because at that point we were still friends. Her response was, well, I know, let's, you know, think about it. Let's, you know, take some time to see, you know, how things work out, and then we'll make a decision after that.
Well, the first time I realized that Delwin was someone that I really wanted to spend the rest of my life with, it was the summer of 2003. He went to finish up some loose ends that he had in Tulsa because he moved back home for a while. And it was very hard with him not being there because before we even began to date, we were friends. So we started our friendship. For 6 months, he pursued me, but finally he got me to give over and say, okay, yeah, we're gonna start dating. But it was so hard those 5 weeks that he was gone. And I realized one evening I sat home after he had called by his sister's house. I would normally go by his sister's house in the evenings to get a call from him. I sat there that evening and I cried like a baby because he wasn't there. And it was hard because I couldn't talk to anyone as I had developed such a confident communication and a relationship with him that I chose not to speak to anyone else. So my person who I would normally go and talk to and get advice from and share the different problems I had during the day with, I tried to get his feedback from, he wasn't there. And it was a really rough time that I was going through at that moment because I was up against all sorts of things. And that's when I realized, hey, this is a person that understands who I am. When I speak, he's able just to finish my sentences for me. There must be more to it than just a relationship if I'm gonna feel these kinds of feelings where I feel as if I'm lost or I'm not complete when he's not around. So I think they were the first moments when I really realized that, hey, there's more to it. I must be truly in love with him and not just liking him per se. And it was really final when he had to go back to school in September that, hey, this can't just be a mutual friendship or a slack relationship. It was more than that. And so that's when we both realize that, hey, this where we were going at that particular point in time.
The first time I told her I loved her was, it was kind of funny because I just dropped her back by Linda and Lionel's place. And she was, you know, walking away from the car, and then she almost said it. So it was like almost, she made it seem like it was almost a mistake. So I had to call her back and tell her what you said, you know, what did you say? And she was like, I was gonna say I love you, but I was like, no, I'm supposed to be the first one to say that. So he said, before you really said, I gotta say it. And he told us the first time I told her I loved her.
Leaving out of bar, the words were snuffed out, I love you. And it was kind of a stilling moment because we both just sat in silence for a couple of seconds. And then I think I said it first. And then he was like, I love you too. Or whatever. It was kind of awkward having said it because it wasn't intentional to say it. But it came out. I guess that was what I was feeling at the moment. And then when he said it back, I understood then that it was a mutual feeling and not just a feeling on my part.
Marissa's reaction was, well, why you didn't say that long time? You know, she acted as though, you know, I was prolonging it. You know, when she was the one who said, let's take some time.
I knew I was in love with Delwin simply because of the way he made me feel. It was never about sex. It was never about feeling, touching one another or anything like that. because he never took it to that point. He was always a gentleman. He always said, we're going to wait until we are married, the way God ordained for it to be. But when you find someone who sits and listens, and I'm just not talking about listening with just your ears, but who listens with your heart and who's able to tell you word for word what you're feeling or what you've expressed back to you, and who's able to go to God for you and not just you go to him alone, who's able to pray for you, who's able to give you words of advice, someone who is able to openly express that love for you, that's when I knew that, hey, I was in love with him, because the feelings were just more than normal feelings. I got butterflies when I saw him, those kind of things, that pit in your stomach, nervousness when I was around him, those kind of things caused me to understand that, hey, it was more than just a like relationship. I grew to love him first. I just didn't fall in love with him. I grew to love him. And then I grew in love with him.
I knew I was in love with Marissa when it was actually something that she did what I did not expect for her to do. And when she did that, it was like the feelings were already there, but that like sealed the deal. And after that, you know, that was it. I knew right then that she had to be the one. Well, what Marissa did was I had some things. I had a loose end I needed to take care of over in Tulsa, right? And I came back. When I came back home, I didn't have the finances to send over there. And I didn't want to concern anyone with that because I felt as though that was my business. Somehow she found out, and the somehow name is Tiffany, my sister, right? And she ended up, Marissa ended up sending the money I needed away. And, you know, the night when I found out, she argued with me because she said that, you know, how could she be a help me if I am not allowing her to help?
We like movies. Every time a new movie comes out, Delwin thinks you gotta go watch it, but it's good because that's when we get time to just sit, watch, laugh, that kind of stuff. We like to watch movies, we like to eat. Let me be blatant, we love to eat together because we always find a joke when we're eating. Either we're eating in a funny manner, chewing in a funny manner. Either I'm drinking too much because I probably didn't have 3 cups of drink before I'm halfway through my meal. But those are the things that we enjoy. We enjoy spending quality time with one another. He's a very homely person. He likes sitting around, talking. He especially likes when he's sharing in the word, that's when he becomes even more intense. But those are the simple things that we like to do together. We like to watch movies. We love to eat. We love to talk about things and get feedback from
us. We spend a lot of time together alone when we have the opportunity because we're mostly around people a lot of the time. We like to go to movies, you know, and the movies is our thing, you know, because that's where we could go to relax most of the time.
The most romantic place or time that we have spent together, I would say, is when we went to, what is it called? We went to a restaurant in Atlantis. I'm not quite familiar with the name. I can't remember the name, but it's one of the restaurants when you walk down the spiral stairs. You have to go downstairs to get into the restaurant. We went there for a birthday dinner, but before we went into dinner or whatever, we sat and we talked around the table and he held my hand and he kissed my hand and stuff like that. It was very romantic because as we were sitting, he was sharing his feelings for me and I was sharing my feelings back to him. And we kind of talked about the hopes and the dreams that we had for ourselves and that we had for one another. And we really kind of got to know one another in a new light on that evening. So that was one of the most romantic times that I can think of.
The most romantic time we spent together, I believe. was at our first real dinner date. What was at Sabaros? Because while we were walking to Sabaros, you know, we were holding hands and she was looking at me and she was like, dude, it's our first real date. And you know, that night was, I think that was the most romantic, most special time that we had.
Proposal wasn't a get down on your knee kind of thing. It was more of a mutual understanding that, hey, this is where you're at, this is where I'm at. This is what we want to do. It wasn't, Marissa, will you marry me or that kind of thing. It was more of, hey, Marissa, I love you and I want to spend the rest of my life with you. What do you think about it? And I responded, hey, that's the same way I feel. And so that's basically how it came about, but there was never a one new kind.
Well, the engagement took place kind of different. I was about to go back to Tulsa, and Marissa was upset because I always had to run out of the country, you know, a lot, because I had to do, you know, close out some things over there. And she was like, D, you know, we don't feel this way about each other for, you know, for slack reasons. And I was like, that's true. So I say, I asked her, I said, so what you want to do? And she was like, what you want to do? So I say, we need to get married. So it was more like, it wasn't like the one knee thing. It was more like we came together and understood that something was happening. And, you know, to let things go the right way, we knew that getting married would have been the proper thing to do.
They have no objections. We've gotten plenty of support. My mother said she knew before I actually knew. She said she knew that, hey, he would be the one. So all she did from day one was pray. My father he's very open about it. He tries to help in whatever way he can. He constantly asks me questions about the wedding. Very supportive group of people that is behind us. So we don't have any negativity on that part. A very loving family that supports us. Both his family and my family support us.
My family felt like they weren't sure at first because we had, you know, a situation before with my older sister getting married, and I guess they felt as though they didn't want me to go through those, you know, type of things that she went through. But after we both talked to them and, you know, sat down and had our little conference meeting, they, you know, it settled in them and they were all for it.
Most part in the future, I would have to say what we're looking most forward to is spending the rest of our lives together. But not only that, we know that we have a purpose, and we're not just getting married for getting married's sake or to say that we're husband and wife or with one another. We're getting married because there's a God-given purpose, and he has a ministry and a call on his life, and I know that I have one too. And what I'm looking forward to most is seeing what God is going to do between the both of us. How is he going to use us separately and apart? Of course, we're looking to all of the other things that marriage holds. The regular things like sharing your life with one another, growing old together, having kids. But what I'm really interested in, because I know those things will come, is with the call that God has on us, where is he going to take us? Where are we going to do in those years together, or however long that he places us together? That's what I'm looking forward to.
I'm mostly looking forward to future-wise. I would say what God has planned for us, like ministry-wise, business-wise, you know, any the areas in our life that, you know, are going to be perfected because of our union, you know? It would basically, I know her heart's desires and music, you know, so I'd love to see where God is going to take her in her music ministry, you know, as well as take me and minister, and, you know, I'm just really looking forward to see where we're going to end up, what God has for us.
The lasting words that I'd like to leave for you, Delwin, is I know that you've been a big pillar of strength for me in the past 2 years. You've understood me when I felt like a lot of other persons who I would have expected to understand me didn't. You understood my fears of being who I am. You understood my weaknesses and you understood my strengths. And I thank you for being the man that you have always been. You've never compromised on your position with God. You've never compromised on your standards. You've been strong. You've been courageous when others have doubted you and when others have told you that, hey, God hasn't called you and God hasn't placed a calling on your life. You said you know what God has said to you. And I thank you for standing up to what you know is in your heart and to the principles that you know you have. And I encourage you, Delwin, that each and every day I want you to grow in grace more and more each and every day. And I want you to know that I do love you. And I plan with everything that is within me and everything that God has placed within me to support you no matter what, no matter how hard it gets. That's my desire, is to stick by you in your dreams and in your goals. And I pray that you would I pray that you would be all that God has designed and created for you to be, not just for ministry's sake, but that your purpose and the plan that God has placed in you is perfected in you. And I just want to say that I love you and that I care so much for you, and I'm looking forward to spending the rest of my life with you as God has intended me to.
We made it this far. We had a lot of ups and downs, you know, a lot of times when we blew our tops because we were upset at each other and stuff like that. But we realized that it was, you know, all for a purpose. And now we made it to this point. And I know if we made it this far, God could continue taking us wherever else he'll have us to go. So, I just want to say, let's continue and go ahead, go on for gold.
You raise me up so I can stand on my
own. Good morning, person.
Yes.
As you can see, this is the garden that you sent for me. Now I want you to watch. Pay attention closely as I demonstrate. All right.
Yeah.
This is the garden that stops.
Yeah.
Yay high. Watch me as I walk. Catch it. You can see it. Can you see it? As it slides down, it slides some more, and bam! Mommy, this is medium. This is a medium garter. Now, I know you wanted me to lose some weight, but it wasn't going to be all of that. All right. But I love you, and I call you again when I got more joke to tell you.
You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy seas. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up so I can stand on mountains. You raise me up. shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. You raise me up to more than I can be.
pray, Lord, this is the day that the Lord has made. We shall rejoice and be glad in it. We're here to witness the joining of two wonderful people today, Marissa Candice Davis and Delwin Dwight Maycock. I'm going to now invite Bishop Sterling Morse, who will indeed moderate the service for today.
Blessed morning to all. Next on our program is a congregational number, Draw Me Closer.
Favor them with your blessings. We pray for
the officiating minister, Apostle Falman Ferguson, as he officiated this ceremony this morning. We ask for your wisdom, your knowledge, and your understanding to rest heavily upon him. We ask for your divine anointing, dear God, to be with him and upon him as he administers, oh God, this ceremony this morning. We give you thanks for the parents and the families of these, your children. We pray for the Maycocks. We pray for the Davis, that you will bless them. And we are giving you thanks for training them and bringing them to this place where they will take on their responsibility and face life together. We ask, dear Lord, that you will come in and bless us in a very special way. We give you thanks and praise for what you have done and what you are about to do today. For we ask it all in your darling Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Just feel that we should now to read the scripture reading. This is Lexis Ferguson.
Chapter 13, 1 through 13. Though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, and have not charity, I am become a sounding brass or a tinkling cymbal. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and though I have all faith so that I could remove mountains, and have not charity, I am nothing. And though I bestow all my goods to feed the poor, and though I give my body to be burned, and have not charity, it profiteth me nothing. Charity suffereth long and is kind. Charity envieth not. Charity wanteth not itself, is not puffed up, doth behave itself unseemly, her own, is not easily provoked, thinketh no evil, rejoiceth not in iniquity, but rejoiceth in truth, beareth all things, believeth all things, hopeth all things, endureth all things. Charity never faileth, but whether there be prophecies, they shall fail. Whether there be tongues, they shall cease. Whether there be knowledge, it shall vanish away. For we know in part, and we are prophesied in part. But when that which is perfect is come, then that which is in part shall be done away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I understood as a child. I thought like a child. I put away childish things. For now we see through a glass, darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even as also I am known. And now abide faith, hope, charity, these things. But the greatest of these is charity. Here ends the reading of God's holy word.
we are gathered together in the sight of God and in the face of this company to join together this man and this woman in holy matrimony, which is commended of Apostle Paul to be honorable among all men, and therefore is not by any to be entered in unadvisedly or lightly, but reverently, discreetly, advisedly, soberly, and in the fear of God. Into this holy estate, these two persons present come now to be joined. If any man can show any just cause why they may not lawfully be joined together, let him now speak, or else hereafter forever hold his peace. Thank you, we are done. You may be seated. I charge and require you both, as ye will answer at the dreadful day of judgment, when the secrets of all hearts shall be disclosed, that either of you know any impediment why ye may not be lawfully joined together in matrimony, ye do now confess it. For be ye well assured that if any persons are joined together otherwise than as God's word doth allow, their marriage is not lawful. Who gives this man, or who gives this woman to be married to this man today?
I don't.
I declare your name, please.
Michael Davis Sr.
Amen. God bless you. After me. I do solemnly declare.
I do solemnly declare.
That I.
That I.
Know not of any lawful impediment.
Know not of any lawful
impediment. Why I, Delwin, Dwight Maycock.
Why I, Delwin, Dwight Maycock.
May not be lawfully joined.
May not be lawfully joined.
Together to Marissa Candace Davis.
Together to Miss Marissa Candace Davis.
And I call upon these persons here.
May I call upon these persons here.
To witness.
To witness.
That I, Delwin, Dwight Maycock.
That I, Delwin, Dwight Maycock.
Do take you, Marissa Candace Davis.
Do take you, Miss Marissa Candace Davis.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
To be my lawfully wedded wife.
Amen. I do solemnly declare.
I do solemnly declare.
That I know not.
That I know not.
Of any lawful impediment.
Of any lawful impediment.
Why I, Marissa Candace Davis.
Marissa Candace Michelle Davis.
May not be lawfully joined together.
May not be lawfully joined together.
To Delwin Dwight Maycock.
To Delwin Dwight Maycock.
And I call upon these persons.
And I call upon these persons.
Here to witness.
Here to witness.
That I, Marissa Candace Michelle Davis.
That I, Marissa Candace Michelle Davis.
Do take you, Delwin Maycock, Dwight Maycock.
Do take you, Delwin Dwight Maycock.
To be my lawfully.
To be my lawfully.
Wedded husband.
Wedded husband.
My God. Will thou take this woman to be thy wedded wife, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Will thou love her, comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep thee only unto her, so long as ye both shall live?
I will.
Marissa? Please repeat that. Marissa Candice Michelle Davis, wilt thou take this man to be thy wedded husband, to live together after God's ordinance in the holy estate of matrimony? Wilt thou obey him and serve him, love and honor, and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep thee only to him so long as he both shall live?
I will.
Amen.
Yep.
Let us pray.
Relax.
I see Bishop, if I can come back. Over pastor. Come on, Bishop. You come and join. Come and join me here. Yeah, he got his call over. That's all. Yes, Lord.
Our Father and our God, in the mighty name of Jesus the Christ, we thank you, Father God, for these two, Lord, today. Delwin and Marissa. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for the joining of these two flesh, that they may become one today. We recognize, God, that marriage, Father God, is ordained by thee. Father, we pray today that you would indeed bless them in thee. Enlarge, Father God, their territory. Keep them from harm and that they would cause no pain. We pray, God, that your divine perfect will would be done in them, O God. For we recognize of themselves they can do nothing. But God, we know with thee, O God, they can do all things. We pray, dear God, that you would indeed be with them throughout life, joining. Father, that they may continue, God, oh God, Lord, to seek your face, to walk before you. God, I declare that no harm will come nigh their dwelling as they seek your face and continue to live before you. God, I pray your blessings upon them from this time, even and forevermore. I thank you, God, that you would prosper them in all of their ways. And, oh God, that they may continue, Lord, to be steadfast and unmovable, always abounding in the works of the Lord.
They need your grace.
And we pray in thy mercy. Done in them,
Lord, in order
the name
to
of Jesus,
fulfill their duties
and
to your honor, to your glory. So, Father, we just bless
thank you, Jesus.
Ask your blessings upon them in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
I want you to repeat after me one more time. I, Delwin Dwight Maycock. Take thee, Marissa Candice Davis.
Take thee, Marissa Candice Davis.
To be my wedded wife.
To be my wedded wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better and for worse.
For better and for worse.
For richer and for poorer.
For richer and for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
Thereto.
I
pledge.
I
plight.
Plight.
Thee my troth.
Thee my troth.
Marissa.
I, Marissa Candice Michelle Davis.
Take thee, Delwin Dwight Maycock.
Take thee, Delwin Dwight Maycock.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
To obey.
To obey.
Till death do us part.
Till death do us part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
Till death us do part.
Till death us do part.
According to God's holy ordinance.
According to God's holy ordinance.
And hereto I plight.
And hereto I plight.
Thee my troth.
Thee my troth.
All right.
don't want to open it.
I give you honor and praise. As I lift these two rings up to you. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost, I declare your blessings upon these rings, that they are ever, as they symbolize, ever ending love. May these two dwell in your presence likewise, from this day henceforth and forevermore. Amen.
With this ring,
I do well, and with all my worldly goods,
I
endure. I'm sorry. Repeat this again. And with all my worldly goods,
I do endow.
In the name of the Father,
and of the Son.
And of the Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen.
Tell you. With this ring,
I be wed,
and with all my worldly goods,
I be endowed,
in the name of the Father,
in the name of the Father,
and of the Son,
and of the Son,
and of the Holy Ghost,
and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen. Please join your right hands. Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. O eternal God, creator and preserver of all mankind, giver of all spiritual grace, the author of everlasting life, send thy blessing upon these servants, this man and this woman, whom we bless in the name, that as Isaac and Rebekah live faithfully together, so these persons may surely perform and keep the vow and covenant betwixt them made, whereof this ring given and received is a token and pledge. And may they ever remain in perfect love and peace together, and live according to thy laws, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Those whom God hath joined together, let no man put asunder. As Delwin, Dwight Maycock, and Marissa, Candice, Michelle, Davis have consented together in holy wedlock, and have witnessed the same before God and this company, and thereto have given and pledged therefrom to each other, and have declared the same by giving and receiving a ring, and by joining of hands. I pronounce that they are man and wife. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost, I declare this as a minister of the gospel and as a marriage officer in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Amen. Everyone say amen.
Amen.
Fill you with all spiritual benediction and grace that ye may so live together in this life that in the world to come ye may have life everlasting.
What you want from me? It's what I want for.
a great pleasure.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
In presenting to you the newest couple in the Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
Yes, yes.
Mr. and Mrs. Part of the program.
We honor you for that today, God. We bless you.
she sit with him? Yes. Compromise is very important. This marriage. Sacredness to each other. Oh my God. Which means that I'm so glad that this couple is leaving to both attend school. They're leaving very shortly. So they will not have too much interaction from their Bahamian counterparts. Thank you, Jesus. Because, you know, Bahamian folk don't know how to let young couples live or breathe. They don't give space. They won't show up the day after marriage. Some show up that night. You know, pretending that they got something to do. But you two must keep yourselves and develop friendship with each other, as I expressed to them. Let Delwin become your best friend. Marissa becomes your best friend. Always sharing the intimate details with each other. And this will lead you to a long and happy marriage. Most importantly, I want to say to you, as I've said to them, keep the family altar open. With God as the center of your marriage. And I want to suggest to you that in the midst of the problems that you will encounter, not may, will encounter, that you would know just who to turn to. And God says, if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God. He enjoys giving and he does not hold back. And so I want to just say to y'all as y'all get ready to leave here, continue to love. Love will grow every day. Remember now, you're two different persons. As you can see, everybody have no rest. Obviously, you got rest. They're all two different people. Huh? Drawn together as one. So you got to remember this now, as y'all go away, that the two of you, in your coming together, especially in these early months, will find out that y'all will be fighting for space. Bear with one another. Always, the Word of God says, soft words, turn it away wrath, and grievous words, stir up anger. So may the Lord go with y'all. I want to say to those who are back here and who may get their phone numbers, please don't call with too many advices. But as y'all continue, I speak over y'all. That the blessings of the triune God will be upon you all. And that the anointing of God will so saturate this marriage that in the midst of everything y'all will experience, the joy of the Lord will always be the shepherd has to sacrifice for his wife. Amen. And the lover, Sister Marissa, God says that you are to obey him and submit to him. Mm-hmm. That's a word that some behavior don't want to hear. I know you will appear to those instructions from the Word of God. Read it for yourself in Ephesians chapter 5. You will see it for yourself. Submit to your own husband, not to no other man speaking of it, to your own husband. Obey him, serve him, and everything will be just all right. All right? And I'm sure that as you all, you know, follow those simple instructions, that your lives will grow stronger every day. 16 years from now, I expect to see y'all with the same joy, the same desire, Marissa with the same smile. Amen. Brother Delwin with the same ego in his spirit for this woman that he was not prepared to wait for any longer. You know, and I'm saying to you, like many others in here who have celebrated longer years than I have, that God will do it in your life. God bless you. Amen. Mr. Michael Davis Sr., he was here today. Would you stand with me so they can see his handsome young fellow? Amen. And of course, his wonderful mother. My God, she's never growing old. All the way out of Abaco. Amen. Sister, asking
Viola
Davis. Okay. Last name. Amen. Anyway, Davis, we honor the Lord for her.
And
two daughters are with. Yes, and her two daughters are with us, Sandra and who else? And Melanie.
Marilyn.
My God, I haven't seen them yet. Marilyn is here. Come on, stand so they can see you. Amen. Amen. Okay, well, let me do all one time. I have the grandfather. The grandfather of Marissa, who's my dad. Luther Glenwood Ferguson. All the way out of it, Zuma. My God, that young man, 76, okay, all young after you. 76 years young. My God, still going to tell me he gotta hurry back home, get home. He gotta get home Monday because the people we forget. And we are so delighted. I said to this handsome young gentleman that he can't be father. He must be the brother. And the brother Maycock, the wife Maycock, and sister Maycock. Amen. The father and mother.
All right, very well.
Amen. So good to have them. And then his lovely
sister is on the
front row here as well. I want the aunties and uncles. Let the aunties, any grandma or grandpa here. That's right. Come on, these folks just want to stay young. Help us, Jesus. All right. And okay. Who else? You have me, Brother Jeremy. You have me.
Nita.
Nita, all right, very well. And all of the family from Brother Delwin's side, would you stand so we can see you? All right, all of the rest of the family, would you stand? All right. Well, dear God, again, and Father, we give thanks and praise unto you for this day one more time. Father God, we thank you for Brother and Sister Maycock. Now, God, as they begin their journey, O Lord God of Israel, bless them indeed. Enlarge their territory. Keep them from harm and that they would cause no pain. We ask these favors in Jesus' name. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give you his peace, is my prayer. Everyone say amen.
Amen.
Marissa, tell me how you feel right now.
I feel good. I'm glad it all happened.
Gentlemen, tell me how you feel right now.
It's like an adequate yet. You're ready to go.
You're ready to go.
Yeah,
now. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
You look beautiful.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
I will always care through weakness and strength.
Congratulations!
Oh,
yes.
Oh,
yes.
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 With every beat of my heart. This moment, life has begun.
From this moment, you are the one.
Right beside you is where I belong. From this moment on,
from this moment, I have been.
Your happiness
and for your love, I'd give my last breath from this moment on.
I give my hand to you.
right now, without further ado, we're going to have the food prayed for and blessed. And we'd like to, at this time, call Mrs. Energene Sims to come and bless the food for us. Let us bow reverently as she comes.
Let's pray. Let's pray. Father, we honor you and bless you for the gift of marriage. And we thank you for this celebration today. And then, Lord, amidst a world of immorality and the escalation of divorce, we thank you for Delwin and Marissa, who have rejected popular opinion, and they did it God's way. And so, Father, I pray today that you will bless them indeed. Father, help their marriage to be one that will be exemplified with the principles of your word, not only in the Bahamas, but wherever they will go. And then, Father, I pray for marriages everywhere, but especially those that are represented in this room today. Lord, some are broken, some are cold, and some are sour. But Lord, I ask today for mending and restoration. And then Lord, I ask that you would bless the food that we will eat and may it do our bodies good and help us to be the ready recipients of your coming. And then Lord, we remember those with appetite and no food and some Lord with food but no appetite. But Lord, we say thanks for food and appetite. Amen.
Amen. Just before we get prepared to have our toast, our first toast, as we all know, the bride of the mother unfortunately is unable to be here on this morning with us. However, we know that she certainly is here in spirit. And on last night, I said to Marissa, I said, you know, God has still blessed you. Because somewhere around this world on this morning, there was a bride that got married that didn't have a mother that she could see no more on this side of the earth. But you know that you can meet your mother again on this side of the earth, so still give God praise. So right now we want to give God a special praise for the mother of the bride. As the service came to an end and I went outside, I peeked into the car. I saw Marissa gazing at him.
Tonight, I celebrate my love for you. Tonight, no one's gonna find us. We'll leave the world behind us when I make love to you.
So at that point, I looked to the Lord and I was dismissed. I don't see anything in your glasses, but I know each and every one of you have water. I know that each and every one of you have water, so I want you to raise your glasses as I propose the first toast on this morning to this wonderful bride and groom. And it goes a little like this. Congratulations on the termination of your isolation. And may I express an appreciation of your determination to end the desperation and frustration which has caused you so much consternation and given you the inspiration to make a combination to bring an acclimation to the population.
Be here this evening and to give a toast to my sister, Marjorie Davis, in our absence. I know right now that her spirit is right here with us. I spoke with her yesterday and for 15 minutes I was on the phone and it's a disappointment, but you know, He said, in all things, give thanks. And that's, it's only, it's good when we have Jesus on our side, and we know what, there are some things when we are disappointed, but we know that God has all things work together for our good. And I'm glad that I have a sister, a woman of faith, a woman with purpose. She knows what she wants, and she not only exercised faith, but she exercised work. And I'm glad that even though in her absence she's not here, I know that God is going to continue to see her through in her endeavors. And I want you to lift your glass with me as I give this toast to Marjorie Davis, a woman of faith.
I'm delighted this afternoon to propose a toast to my sister, Margie. Like my brother said, we're so saddened that she isn't here right now. But I don't want it to sound as if I'm not going to see her again. But I was anxious to see her, having not seen her for so long. And many of you know her, and those who don't know her, she's a lady of many qualities. First of all, she is a family woman. She loves her children, and she would go to any lengths to make sacrifice for them. Therefore, she is a good mother. She loves her sibling. I'm part of that. Her brothers, her sisters, her mother who's deceased, her dad who's here. She's a family woman. And no wonder people always remember, someone saw me today and they said, "Hi, Margie." And I had to say, "No, this is Barbara." She is known, I mean, in our circle of family, that's the one name that people normally remember, Margie, because of the qualities that she possessed. When I came to Nassau, about 21 years ago, she was staying with a relative. And because I didn't have anywhere to stay, she decided to come away, move away from the relatives, and we all stayed together. And she taught me so many things. Along with my two brothers, we all stayed together as a family. And I appreciate them because the love that I felt being away from home, being with them, it was indeed a joy. When she moved to Tampa, then to Tulsa, I missed her. But, you know, we speak often on the phone, and I thank God for her. I recall so many times when we had family gathering. Margie is unselfish. And many times we would be wondering, whose house are we going to meet at? And she was always there. You could come at my house. When others were like, oh, too much work, she was always there to say welcome. She welcomed you to her home, and I thank God for her. She is one in a million, and oh, we just thank God for her being a part of our family. She's a friend. She's a friend to many, and also to us as her siblings. We call her friend. We call her sister. I recall when she was in nursing school, their summers or Christmas would not go by unless she brought home one of her friends from the nursing school, and that said a lot, because so many people are embarrassed from where they came from, but not Margie. She brought her friends home so they could have a taste of many friends, because she showed herself to be friendly. I can go on and on and on, letting you know some of the things you already, just reminding you of some of the things that you already know as being a leader, a confident advisor. Oh, she's that and more. And I'd like to say that she's a survivor. Whatever adversity came her way, she just used it as a stepping stone and just continued to smile, continued to go forward. And I really admire her for that. She is a professional woman. A woman, I mean, she's a nurse by profession, but I would say going on doctor. She will be our first doctor in the family.
Well, you have one.
Oh, well.
Exactly.
Immediate family. She loves to cook. Anybody who knows Nachi? Oh my. And she loves to experiment. I told her she is blessed because I can't do that. My husband is a man who just loves the traditional, but she loves to experiment. She would take the cookbook and experiment with anything that she wants to, and it comes out good. Thank God for that. Many afternoon after work, I used to stop by her to just see what she had prepared, and it was something good. And above all, I left this for the last, because I think this is what kept her and what is keeping her now. She is a godly woman. She is a godly woman, and I think because of the things that she went through in her life, she has gotten closer and closer to the Lord, and she, it's her desire. You know, sometimes she, I hear praying for children and whatnot, and it's like, I want you to be saved. That was her desire. That is her desire, that her family be saved, because she knows that it's only what you do for Christ is going to last. Therefore, she has taken up on the challenge and accepted the Lord as a Savior. And I'd like you to stand right now as we propose a toast to my sister who is not here. My beloved sister, my mother, after the passing of my mother, my friend, my confidant, my sister, Margie Davis, we love you. God bless you.
Something awesome started in the service on today. And it started right after the marriage vows would have been said and the register would have been signed and everything would have become legal. And the bride and groom gave us a preview of what would be happening later on tonight. And I wonder if those of you who may still be in your seats and have a fork or a spoon or something, we can make some noise in here and signify that we want to see some more action up on this podium this morning, today. Bride and groom, when you hear that twinkling sound, that means show your love one to another. One to another. That sound ain't soft. Close to the bride's father, Minister Larry Thurston, as he comes to the podium right now. Let's welcome him as he comes.
Let the church say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. Hallelujah. That's much better. Thank you, Madam Moderator. Special invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, good afternoon. It is my singular honor and privilege to have been asked to propose a toast on behalf of the bride's father, Mr. Michael Davis. For I know that many others were quite capable of fulfilling this task. Marissa and Delwin, I know this is your day. This is definitely your day. And it's not my intention to give Mr. Davis all the glory. But please permit me, as I have risen to my feet, to say a few words from my heart on his behalf. 1 Corinthians 4 and 15 states, "For though you have 10,000 instructors in Christ, you have yet have ye not many fathers." Michael Davis is truly a father, a priest. Now, I would be foolhardy to stand here and try to suggest to you that he is a perfect gentleman. I wish I could have stood here and proclaimed that he was perfect and that he has never had to overcome any challenges, but that is not the case. He too has had to drink from a bitter cup. And like most of us, we weren't always in the church. It left him wondering and lost, like the prodigal son. But like the prodigal son, he too came to his senses and said, I will arise and go to my father's house. He too can testify and say, if it hadn't been for the Lord on my side, where would I be today? Presently, he serves as a minister / pastor at the Golden Gates World Outreach Ministries on Carmichael Road, where in the last year he has occupied the position of our church controller. Now, any of you know, thank you, United, you could attest to this, you know, it ain't easy to handle church folks' money. That's a testament right there within itself that, you know, he's a man of distinction. But on a serious note, having to serve in that capacity, our bishop and apostle, Ross Davis, seeing virtue in him, asked him to serve, and he has done a remarkable job thus far. He is a portrait of integrity, a model citizen, one that mothers wouldn't mind their sons emulating. He symbolizes truth. He is the epitome of humility, meekness, and strength. A businessman of the highest order. A man I have come to love, honor, admire, and cherish. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand with me as we toast to this legend in the making. A godly CEO, a husband, a brother, a son of the sword, my friend and father of the bride, Mr. Michael Davis. May goodness and mercy follow you all the days of your long life, my brother. Peace.
To the groom's parents, coming from Mrs. Patricia Sands.
Let's welcome Miss Patricia Sands as she comes to give a toast to the groom.
This is mistress of ceremonies, families, friends, and well-wishers. On this very special day, I am indeed honored and delighted to propose a toast to the handsome king of Farmers Key Exuma and the beautiful queen of the city, New Providence. These are the proud parents of the prince for this special occasion. Along with the gorgeous parents, Mr. and Mrs. Dwight Maycock, Delwin's grandmother, Mom, as she is called, must be recognized to complete the triangle because she played a vital role in helping to rear him to become the man of the hour. To know this family is like a gift from God, a blessing. Naturally, they are nice people who lend a helping hand, give words of comfort, encouragement, cheer, and loyal friendship. They are sensitive to the needs of others, always going the extra mile. They are ambitious, hardworking, and of course, a great provider, never settling for second best. They are determined and dedicated to God, always displaying Christian values. They are the role models for their family and to our society at large. The Maycocks are serious about their relationship. Love is the hallmark for their home. They support and encourage each other and the children to reach their potential goals. They are a good example of God's love at work in this world. It shows in their everyday living. All the good they do help to make a better world. I am sure if Delwin imitates his parents' lifestyle, he will be a role model for other young men to follow. All of these accolades are in order for the parents and grandparents of Delwin. There are other values I can share, but I give you an idea about the Maycocks. At this time, I would like to invite Dwight and Cynthia Maycock to stand and give them a rousing round of applause. Please join me, raise your glass for the continuous health, happiness, and success of this family. I want to thank you and also thank God for the excellent job you have done in rearing a respectable husband for the bride today.
All right then.
Just before I call upon Mrs. Sharonique Rami to give the toast to the bride, I know that there are some single folk that are in the room. And so perhaps something that is said or done here today may assist you in joining in with the rites of having MM behind your name. The MM stands for Marriage Maker. With this in mind, there's a little story that goes something like this. There's a store that's called Husband Mart. And it's a store that sells husbands. It has just opened where a woman may go to choose a husband from among many men. Now that's the best kept secret, so if you want to know, you're going to have to come see me afterwards. The store is composed of 6 floors, and the men increase in positive attributes as the store ascends the flights. There is, however, a catch. As you open the door to any floor, you may choose a man from that floor. But if you go up a floor, you cannot go back down except to exit the building. So here we go now. A female customer goes into the shopping center to find herself a husband. On the first floor, the sign on the door reads, Floor 1. These men have jobs. The woman reads the sign and says to herself, well, that's better than my last boyfriend, but I wonder what's further up. So up she goes. The second floor sign reads, Floor 2. These men have jobs and love kids. The woman remarks to herself, that's great, but I wonder what's further up. And up she goes again. The third floor sign reads, Floor 3. These men have jobs, love kids, and are extremely good looking. Better still, she says. But I wonder what's upstairs. The fourth floor sign reads, floor four. These men have jobs, love kids, are extremely good looking, and help with the housework. Wow, exclaims the woman. Very tempting, but there must be a little bit more. And again, she heads up another flight. The fifth floor sign reads floor five. These men have jobs, love kids, are extremely good looking, help with the housework, and have a strong romantic streak. She starts fanning. Oh, mercy me. But just think, what must be awaiting me further? So up to the sixth floor she goes. The sixth floor sign reads, floor six. You are visitor number 3,456,789 to this floor. There are no men on this floor. This floor exists solely as proof that women are impossible to please. Thank you for shopping at Husband Mart. Get out of this place and have a wonderful day. Put your hands together as we welcome Mrs. Sharonique Rami to give a toast to the bride.
For those that don't know me as Sharonique, my name is Tomika. I don't know where to begin, but let's start here. I met Marissa from, I was about 7 years of age, the Church of God in Prophecy Soul Group. We had a lot of sleepovers, a lot of sneaking out. Sister Maggie was like a mother to me, and Marissa was like a sister to me. So I accepted her as my sister. Me and Marissa grew up to be what we look like today. Knowing Marissa, Marissa is a very special friend to me. No matter what I may be going through, she always has an encouraging word. To Marissa, words cannot express what I have to say. But just to let you know that I love you. Being a task as a wife is not easy. But to accomplish being a task of a wife, you gotta put God first no matter what. Nothing is impossible for God. So just being the friend that she was to me, loyal, trustworthy, loving, respectable, that's the role you take into your marriage. And Delwin, you have a good, good wife. Because she's surely a good friend. When I told Marissa that I was pregnant with my first son, with my first child, she took the news as if she had just found out that she was pregnant. She was all excited. She was surprised at first because she didn't know I was pregnant because she was in here. But when she did find out, she accepted Corban as her own. You know, even though I felt like my friends had turned their back on me, she was always the one to be there for me. So I want you to raise your glass with me to the toast to the most wonderful friend in the whole wide world. No one can replace her. No one can take the love that she has. And when I found out Marissa was getting married, I was so sweet. highlight the fact that, you know, everybody is growing up and being their own woman. Because I never expected Marissa to grow up to be a woman. So I want you to raise your glass with me to wish Marissa to be a humble, a submissive wife, to acknowledge that Delwin is the head of the home. But before Delwin, it comes God. God is the head of your home and your marriage. So everything that you go through, good times and bad times, you put God first. Cheers.
There'd be no bride if you didn't have a groom. And so the man of the hour is going to be toasted by Mr. Terranio Maycock. Terranio, I'm so sorry. Terranio Maycock. Let's welcome him as he comes.
Can I get an amen in this place? Amen. Thank you. This young man, my brother, as long as I know him for all his years, as he's been on this earth, he is a great man. He's a man who doesn't go looking for a woman to approach or to just go and deal with on the side. He's a man who is full of love, and he respects God, and he believes in following God's wishes. And I truly can say to Marissa that if she is really getting a man of God, a man of dignity and full of faith, you know? So, when things get rough, don't go call Susie on the corner. You talk to your husband on the side. And I promise you, God will see y'all through everything. And I raise my glass to y'all and to my brother for the long life and good health. And may God bless all to y'all.
I try to think this like the most saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost people who got married for so long. Ain't me and I'm juicy yet. Anyway, we must have got to do this again a week after the honeymoon. Right now, we have a lovely cake that's in the front of us, and we'd like to welcome the bride and groom to come as they have their first dessert. As they have their first dessert with the cutting of the cake.
People wait a
Really and truly, it's a very serious financial commitment. But we love to give God thanks and praise for these awesome friends and family members who stepped up to the plate and said, yes, we will stand with you because we believe in what you are doing. You are doing it God's way. And we want to give God thanks and praise for this bridal party who, I mean, you look spectacular. And we bless the Lord for you this morning. Let's give them another cheer. We'd like to thank the parents of both the bride and groom for such an awesome job that they've done to raise and nurture these two, that they would be fit and suitable for this marriage life. We'd also like to thank Apostle Farman Ferguson, the pastor, Marissa, for the counseling and for the encouragement, and as well as Brother Delwin's pastor. We'd like to give God thanks and praise for Bishop Fraser, who is still here, his lovely wife. God bless you. Thank you so much for your input into this couple. All the friends, the family, the loved ones, we'd like to say a special thank you, because without you, there would not be this wonderful fellowship today. We give God thanks and praise because truly, I believe that this is a match made in heaven. And I thank God for what is done in the spirit. We will see it here in the flesh. And so, as I take my leave, I'd like you to raise your glasses one more time. May these rich blessings be your due. A wealth of friendships, old and new, quiet nights and busy days, time for prayer and time for praise. Some service rendered, some solace given, and gentle peace with God and heaven. May the Lord bless you. Also, I'd like to welcome Apostle Farman Ferguson to the podium, so that he can give us the benediction for this evening. Amen. Bless the Lord.
God bless you. It's grace time. The Lord bless thee and keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee and give you his peace. Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
House on the floor.